we are going to start. It's the Mike Tech Show, show number 766. Hello, everybody. Welcome to the podcast. I'm your host, Mike Smith. Thank you very much for downloading and subscribing to the show. Please visit the main website at miketechshow.com. You can email me questions and suggestions for show topics at miketechshow@gmail.com. You can leave me a voicemail message on Skype. The name is Mike Tech Show, all one word. You can follow me on Twitter, twitter.com/miketechshow, and also facebook.com/Mike Tech Show. This show is brought to you by Instant House Call. Remotely support your customers unattended and on demand through firewalls. Try it free by clicking on the link on my website at miketechshow.com. Use the promo code Mike Tech Show for your free 15-day trial. You can also go directly to instanthousecall.com. All of a sudden, my throat. This show is also brought to you by MagnusBox for secure, reliable, affordable cloud backup for your clients from a company that only sells to resellers, MSPs, and supports the channel. The answer is MagnusBox. They have great pricing, support all platforms, Windows, Windows Server, Mac, Linux. And if you mention the Mike Tech Show, you get half price for your first 3 months for the platform fee. Tell them you heard it on the Mike Tech Show. Here's something very important. I had a technical question and an issue with backups on one server this week. I sent an email. The MagnusBox support team contacted me right away, worked on it, fixed it right away, and then followed up. That's what you want from a vendor for supporting your backups. If everything's going great, sure, that's nice. But it's when you have a problem, how is the company there to help you? And MagnusBox support jumped all over it and solved it. And that was an important server because my first story tonight, we're going to be talking about that server. So it was very important that I got a backup on that day. So anyway, thank you to the team at MagnusBox. And that's why we like them as a sponsor, because I use it all the time. So today's show, and I say today, I'm recording this Saturday afternoon because Thursday night I had some work scheduled and it was starting to back up a whole bunch of work. And so I figured, let me get out there and reschedule the show for Saturday. I knew things would be better on Saturday. So we have an email and software migration story. We finally migrated that law firm to the cloud software. Oh my, the lessons learned that I'm going to share here and the links, very important. I have a question about opening a PDF in Adobe instead of a browser on the Mac. We have an Intel Optane error that I ran into, a Cronus 21, an annoyance, and some emails that's going to involve vendors Crescendo and Synex. So we got a big show. Before we start, I want to mention the next 2 weeks. Next week, or I should say Thursday, I am going to talk about the phone migrations from my wife and I from AT&T to T-Mobile, new Android, new iPhone, and all of the software and things you need to know, and some really great links, including a website to compare any phone to any phone, any model, doesn't matter. So very, very good stuff for next week, and look forward to that. And then the week after that, Corey Fruitman, owner of Instant House Call, will be on my show as a guest. You know I never have guests, but the topic, you would say, oh, it's going to be remote control. No. He's going to talk about privacy. And this is going to be a lot of fun. The whole show is going to be dedicated to privacy and de-Googling. So stay tuned for that. So we already have things lined up. Let's begin with first the email migration. In order, and a few months ago, actually back in November, we ran into a problem where we discovered trying to go from the Needles server-based software for case management going to Neos, which is the Needles cloud version, we discovered you have to have email hosted at Microsoft 365, not just the Office apps, which we thought. Now, everything was purchased through ShareWeb, but the email was hosted on the Exchange web server at ShareWeb. I had to have ShareWeb migrate us from the ShareWeb servers to the Microsoft servers. Okay, no problem. We started that project out not this week, but the end of the week before. And everything was going well. We started the transfer of email and their first tests. Everything went good. All I had to do was create the records, the email, the proper email accounts in the admin of Office 365. And or I keep calling it that. I know it's called Microsoft 365 now, and they had Microsoft 365 standard. So now I have to do the DNS change. Not this Friday, not yesterday, but the week before. And I start the DNS change. Mail is coming in. Now I got to create new profiles on each of their Outlook clients so the new email, all their old email can start coming down. I have four of the users, no problem. So my son and I are remoting into everybody. We are able to activate the email accounts for four of the users. Two of the users, it was driving us crazy. I mean, all Friday afternoon, working with ShareWeb tech support, we were doing everything humanly possible to try. I mean, reinstalling Office. So Friday night, I decided to do a test. We took a break and said, okay, we'll continue this on Saturday. I had my son on alert in case he had to go into the office in Center City, Philadelphia, but I figured we could do this remotely. We lost access to one of the systems. Luckily, one of the attorneys was coming in on Saturday morning and was going to start it up. So I went to bed. Oh, no, before I did that, Friday night, I created a profile for both users on my Outlook here, and it went perfect. So we know there's nothing wrong with the account. There's nothing wrong with any settings on ShareWeb side or the Microsoft side, because I was able to download all of their email. And as a safety, I quickly exported it to PSTs just in case. And they didn't have a lot of mail, these two users. I go to bed Friday night. I wake up 5 a.m. with the following idea. What is different between the four systems that it worked and the two systems that it did not? Well, the two systems did not somehow escaped us and was an older build of Windows 10, where those four new ones were, two of them were 20 H2, one of them was 18 something, and I knew I had to upgrade. So I went to these two systems, downloaded the media creation tool, the Windows 10 media creation tool, and did update this system. Took over an hour, updated. I went in and created the profile in 2 seconds. No problem. That was it. It was a Windows 10 problem. So once the attorney came in at 9, he turned on the system we didn't have access to, did the same thing, boom, 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 everything's good. Okay. So you're saying, okay, that went well. So now, Monday afternoon, I kick off the sync, which is from the Small Business Server 2011. Yes, that's what we're trying to migrate off of. I have these scripts with the SharePoint migration tool. I kick them off for everything to be sent up to the SharePoint that is going to be shared with Neos. That went perfectly. As a matter of fact, before I started it at 3, and by 7 p.m., it was all done, the sync. So now, on Tuesday morning of the cutover, 5 of the users, we have no problem. No problem setting up calendar permissions and getting everything to work with Neos. Except one user, and that drove us insane. So what I am going to do is I'm going to, for everybody watching, I am going to show you exactly what we were doing here. And this is the first site for the show notes. So I'm pasting that into the chat right now. And we found this on an Apple forum. Very interesting. Man, we were Googling and Googling and trying to find out a method for sharing calendars in Office 365. And this is on native Mac and iOS clients. Now, it's interesting. This particular user, this attorney, is Windows in the office, but a MacBook Pro at home. So this is very interesting. Did something happen with his office? But here, I'm going to, if you scroll down, once you get to the page, the sharing and permissions, we could not pick can edit. It wouldn't allow us. We kept getting an error. And it was really annoying. So, what we found is this PowerShell commands that you need to apply. You have to open PowerShell as an administrator. There are some very complex commands here. We had nothing to lose, and the tech was like, I've never done this. And I said, I've never done it either. And he said, a company the day before on the migration had the same error that they have not been able to solve yet. And he told me that. And he says, I'm very interested if this is going to work. He says, if you're willing to try. I made sure I had a restore point before we tried this. But it doesn't change anything on the local system. It's really changing everything on your Exchange host provider, which this is now Microsoft. There is, the first command is $PSVersionTable. Then you set an execution policy, remote signed. You have to install a module and answer questions yes. Then here's the big thing. After you connect to the Exchange online, you have to get the mailbox folder permission. And this is where we seen it was not set. Then we set the permission to have the default access rights as editor. And that modifies and changes the common user account. Now we get folder permissions again for that email and check. It was there. It was done. The two of us, and this is a shout out to Keith. Keith and I were giddy. We were so excited that we were able to do this and solve it. And now he could update tickets from the day before. Okay. So now that is that problem. So we just, it's just, man, every time we hit something, it was just unbelievable. So now, okay, you figure this is it. Okay, we're past everything. No, we're not. One of the other attorneys has, as I said, there's a lot of links and stories here that's going to solve this. He has an iMac that he's been working at home during the pandemic editing his files. I now have to get his 100 gig of files from iCloud, and I got to get that into SharePoint online. I couldn't do it from his iMac. We just couldn't drag and drop it. It just wasn't happening. I couldn't drag and drop it from his office, from his system. But I know I could install Windows, I installed iCloud for Windows, which now is a Windows 10 app, figuring now I can get a regular File Explorer and I can copy everything over to the server, which is where I had to get onto the regular server in their office so that I could sync again with those scripts, for at least this one was just one script, to SharePoint. Well, iCloud for Windows wouldn't install. I had to upgrade that Windows 10. So now everybody's at 20H2. So I upgrade that. Then I'm like, I am not going to drag and drop anything. I am going to use SyncBack. I download the free version. I start copying from iCloud to the server. That took all day. It's now early evening, and I'm able to then run the script for the SharePoint migration tool, and I can sync that directory. That only took a couple hours. Everything was synced. Project done, except for questions when training, and it's really using SharePoint. Any questions on how to use Neos, that's taken care of by the Neos support team, not me, you know, the company Needles. So here's one question that we have that came from this project. That particular user, now that he's working off SharePoint, when he opens a PDF directly, he wants Adobe in the Mac to open, not the browser. And it doesn't matter what browser. We know we can't use Safari because Neos doesn't support it. So we're talking Chrome or Firefox. I need help. I've been looking at all the links on how to change. How do you get the Mac Adobe to open up and not open up within the browser? He now has to go through extra steps of downloading that file, then opening up, then editing it, then doing the upload. If he could just open it right into Adobe directly, he could edit it and click Save As, and it would go right to SharePoint. Can't do that. So just figured I would throw that out there and hope to get help. All right. Some more errors and links. How to resolve an Intel Optane memory pinning error. I got the solution, and it's from intel.com. Follow the steps. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, you have a couple options here to try. So the what we did was updated the driver, opening device manager, and making sure that that would work. You can uninstall the device, and then you can update the driver. This is a great link on how to get rid of this problem. And I, you know what? Now I'm sorry about this. We clicked repair, so it was the very first thing, how to fix it, that worked. So you have to go into programs and features. Then you highlight the Intel Optane Pinning Explorer extension and click repair. All right. Now, let's go on to the next errors that we were resolving. Outlook, again, lots of Outlook problems. An error trying to add an email account to a profile on hosted Exchange. And it's a very specific error. This action cannot be completed. The name cannot be matched to a name in the address list. We did two things. It's a credential manager issue. I'm going to have the link for this. And then we just did a repair anyway of Office. Boom, problem fixed. An annoyance that I ran into, which is Acronis 2021. Just a real pain in the neck on getting that to stop popping up ads. I'm like, why are they popping up ads for me to buy Acronis 2021 from within Acronis 2021? That's just disgraceful. But I'm going to help you with how to get rid of that. I have to pause because Acronis somehow closed. And I don't want to waste time. So I'm opening it up right now, Acronis. And then I want to get to that option. So let's wait for a second as I pause the audio, but not the video. So if you're watching the video live you're gonna see this. So we go setting. Okay. Open up Acronis TrueImage 2021. Go to settings, scroll down, and you'll have a couple things you can set. One is the customer experience program. I don't want to participate in that. The next one is personalized offer. It's checked by default. Show personalized offers about products and features. Uncheck it. That's it. Just uncheck it. And all those annoying pop-ups that were happening stopped. So something else I did when I was in the forums, and this is interesting. If you post to an Acronis forum asking to be taken off their mailing list so you don't get spam, they will do that. I did that. So I know what I'm getting with Acronis. I know when I buy it. I know when I upgrade it. And just a quick diversion, Acronis, I'm using that here to back up my system locally. And it was well worth it. Got a nice external drive. A quick reminder here because it's in my notes and I wanted to review this. Just as a quick reminder, anybody that has 1099s, you want to work on getting them out. And my bookkeeper used my QuickBooks Online and he just sent me the email. My 1099s were sent out electronically and all was good. I'm very happy and I'm meeting that deadline early before the end of January. Anybody that has someone that's been working for you where you got to get your 1099 out, get on that. Don't forget it. That's why I wanted to remind everybody. Let's get to some email. And the first email, and I think he's in the chat, is Dexter. Thanks for the great shows. Make sure you put that coat on. You know, I'm one of the few people walking around in shorts no matter what the temp is outside because to me, it's just summer. So he's got three questions for the community. One, in Windows 10, when you plug in a new device in or new emails or those darn notifications, how do you stop the sound? Like plugging in a new flash drive. Great question. And I don't have the answer. So what I would like to do is investigate that. And I'm going to do that, Dexter, where look at the sound settings. I would say deep dive that. Notifications. Man, I turn off all notifications. I know in Outlook, you can absolutely stop the signs going to sounds, going to the options and the tools, within Outlook, whatever version you're using, I know you can disable the sound for that because I've done it. I don't even like the pop-ups of when a new email comes in. Number two, any way to repair a VM instance, disk or just control file. I am calling out to Winston Wolf, our VM expert. Winston, if you can shed some light on this for Dexter, I would appreciate it. Number three, had someone ask that when he makes a call from the iPhone, instead of showing cell number or receiving on receiving end, make it show his office number. Man, Dexter, you had great questions. I wish I could have just rattled off answers, but I can't. So again, how do we stop the sound from plugging in devices into Windows 10? Personally, I like that because I know it's working. I know that the connection, but I get it. You want that off. How do we repair a VM instance? And how can we show a name instead of the office number from an iPhone? How can we show? Now, that's an interesting question because on my iPhone, when I receive a call, if I have a contact, it's going to come up with that contact name. It's not going to come up with the number. So that's an interest. So he still may not be able to just broadcast the name because this could be phone specific. So he could still, when he, you know, makes a call, I'm assuming he or she, when they make a call, it depends what's in the contacts for that person's phone. So I wanted to put that out there. This is from BCom Computers. Morning, Mike. I was listening to your last podcast. You mentioned a Wi-Fi mesh router and heard you mention it before, but was driving and didn't catch the name and model. It's the ASUS AC1900 series. I love the ASUSes. I'm going to have our Amazon link in the show notes. I buy so many of them and recommend them. And just a shameless plug, if you please buy from Amazon, you help support the Mike Tech Show, Tech Vets, Carrie Holzman, and myself. Just use our link in the show notes and do that before you add items to your cart. So the link I sent BCom was my Amazon, a shortcut to the Amazon link for that specific product. So when you click on that, you're going to be able to buy it right away and we'll get credit for it. Your price stays the same. A small commission comes back. Please use our link. Next question, phone service from David. Mike, I had some great experience with a cloud-based phone service by the name of Crescendo. I'm going to have a link in the show notes. It's a very easy service to partner with and almost turnkey for partners like us. They price out the service to take care of the transfer and porting and really do everything for you. All you need to do is configure the firewall and drop the phones in place. They are all voice over IP on the internet and plug and play. You get a percentage every month plus a bonus on the sale. Dave, I am going to check them out and reach out to Crescendo. Anybody else using Crescendo, please weigh in for that. I would really appreciate it. This is from Terry from Arizona. Every kid in the school district has an iPad or Chromebook. What a nightmare to support. Kids bust the screens on a regular basis. Yeah, I would assume they would. Just got two Chromebooks today that are damaged. So much, it looks like they were thrown out of a second story window. The Lenovo Chromebooks have been terrible for needing warranty repairs. They have a much higher failure rate than the cheap Windows laptops we used to buy from Dell. So interesting. I would like to, is there a way, and it's interesting, the next email is going to help with device management from the iPad. So, Terry, give a listen to this email. Hi, Mike. I listened to your last two shows, one from the Mike Tech Show, Show 765, and the last Podnuts Pro of the year. I'm in my 18th year running my computer repair business and live through all of the same challenges you talk about on your show, and I'm always trying to streamline and do more contract type MSP work, and I narrow my tech stack as much as possible. One thing I am never too concerned about is the single pane of glass style RMM or PSA tool. I'm more focused on what tools do the best job for looking after my clients. Do I have many of these windows open at the same time? Yes, but some only for a few minutes to check on the status of computers, etc. Does it have to be all the same pane of glass? No, because some only require a 5-minute check in the morning, and then that is good for the day. And we have seen with the SolarWinds issue, maybe it's not a good idea to put all your eggs in one basket. I don't have to have a single pane of glass, and I don't, except for I do have that RMM PSA, which takes care of a lot. But I still have my backups. I go through the pane of glass that is separate on Magnus Box. We have instant house call that's not tied in for remote access to my Synchro. So we have that. So there are a few things that I'm not, they're not all combined into that single pane. First comment, reselling Office 365. I resell through Synax. I think Marvin works with Synax also. I'm going to reach out to Marvin about that. Anyway, you can set up an account with them to resell MS-O365, G Suite, etc. They have both options available to you on a per-client basis if you want to support the client or have them support the client. Of course, the margins are less if they support. But really, with most small businesses supporting Office 365, it's not hard and creates more charged labor. Synax also has a direct contact on staff with Microsoft, Google, etc. So any troubles, they will look after it. I will check into that. On Podnuts Pro, you mentioned you were concerned about not being paid or someone's credit card expires and you have to chase them for payment. Here's how I deal with that. I have most of my clients set up with Synax on a month-to-month plan for O365, G Suite, etc. I invoice them quarterly in advance so their payment is due before the next quarter starts. If you have a late payer, you can chase them for a month. If no response, you can go to the portal and suspend their account. You're not out anything as you received the first 30 days free, which you have already been paid for by the client. So for setting up reoccurring invoices in your PSA to earn $3 to $4 a seat can add up for some extra quarterly income, which helps cash flow. And of course, all are staggered somewhat. So it's monthly income. Yes, I agree with that. I also use the same approach for charging for backups, Magnus Box and StorageCraft, and for my yearly Untangle subscriptions. Boy, you and I match up perfectly with our product offerings, as some of those are very high numbers, all invoiced and paid in advance. Yes, as a matter of fact, one of my Untangle subscriptions, I had to not allow it to renew. And as a matter of fact, I had to contact Untangle because I thought that was kind of ugly that I wasn't allowed to turn off the renewal. I had to actually contact them and give them a reason why that was being turned off. It's because the client was going out of business and they had a firewall. And this is really sad. This is a company that was going live January of 2020. Could you imagine that? They couldn't get off the ground. And in December, we set up a untangle firewall and also Synology, all sorts of stuff. So that is very, very sad. So they couldn't renew. Comment two regarding mobile device management, iOS, Android, etc., which is built into my MSP antivirus software with many, many features, including encryption, etc. But this email is already too long. I need that. Mark, please send me another email on monitoring iOS and Android and how you do that. I really want to know that. So he would be happy to have that conversation. Oh, and I just implemented remote hard drive monitoring, temperature, etc. We do that within Synchro, and that is very easy with a monitoring policy that we can apply based on what they're paying and what they want to know. Love your show. Should be longer. Well, this one's a little longer. Keep up the good work, and I'm glad you take COVID seriously. Thank you, Mark. Please follow up with that software. Last email of the day, and this is from Austin. Austin, I did get your email for today, and I will reply. So here's what he was asking. How do I produce my podcast? What is the process? And I'm just going to outline it here that I replied to in an email. He is doing a podcast, and I'm not ready right now. I have to download. I haven't had a chance to listen to it. I'm going to listen to it and link it, and I'm going to do that next week, Austin, I promise. Here's my process. I record the podcast. Well, first OBS I open up and to broadcast to Twitch, which is what anybody's seeing this right now. And the video that you see is being recorded from within OBS Studio. I open up Audacity and record the podcast. I save it in the default Audacity format. When this is all done and I'm logged off for the day, I will edit the podcast. I will save it in that default format. The post-production that I do is I select everything in Audacity and I apply the compressor effect with all the defaults. I then again select all and I apply the normalize effect again. All in the defaults. Once I save it, I then export it to a WAV file. I then open Authentic Leveler desktop app. I drag the WAV file into the app, let it process, and that converts it and it levels the audio. That is important, especially when I have a guest and I'm using Skype and the audio levels keep fluctuating. This flattens everything and keeps it consistent. I then have that MP3. I edit the ID3 tag of the MP3. I test it. I play a little bit, skipping through it. Then I post it up to Libsyn. Then I go into my WordPress blog for the podcast and I post that all. There's a lot of little things after that with the RSS feed and things like that. I didn't get into it. Well, now Austin's follow-up email today is about that WordPress and getting everything set up. So I have some ideas and I'm going to email him. So that is it for today's show. Remember, use our Amazon link. Please support the sponsors. Magnus Box for all your backup needs online, Instant House Call for remote access, and Fabs Auto Backup 7 Pro is phenomenal. It is the go-to software that we use all the time for transferring settings and information from one system to another. That's it. Next show will be Thursday night on the 21st. Hopefully 7:30 p.m. and join me there live in the Twitch chat room. And everybody have a great weekend. Please stay safe. Please wear your mask. Protect you. Protect everybody else. That's it. See everybody at the next show. Bye-bye.
You've been listening to The Mike Tech Show, a proud member of the Tech Podcast Network. Please visit techpodcast.com.
You know what I was doing? I lost track there. I was looking at all the follow-ups you guys already. thank you. I will get to them after the show. I really appreciate that. Let's stop.